Today's show is brought to you by Fandor. Sign up online or in the app for a free one-week trial. Just $4.99 a month for your all-access pass. Playing now on Fandor is a romantic comedy, New York, I Love You, starring Natalie Portman, Ethan Hawke, Andy Garcia, and many more. That's F-A-N-D-O-R.
All right, everyone, we're back. And for those of you who were listening to part one, we are you're reminded we're here with the great Tyler Florence, chef.
Thank you, Chris. Thank you, Hooman. And Brian, you're doing an amazing job.
Yeah,
thank
Brian.
You. Thank you. Yeah.
Nobody does a tech check like this guy. It was flawless. It was a great experience.
So for those of you tuning in for the first time, we're reviewing the new Anthony Bourdain movie, Roadrunner. And part one was kind of all about the light side of the film, the fun side, the moments where you got to see kind of a calmer version of Anthony Bourdain.
And then just the force of nature that he was, as Tyler described it in part one. He just an incredible person, you know, blowing through the universe in a whole bunch of exciting ways.
So, Tyler, I'm going to go ahead and say you're one of the 25 most famous chefs in the world. I'm just going to throw that out there. Whether or not whether or not you disagree, I'm going to give you that. Chris, do you agree with
that? Listen, I appreciate that. Thank you very much. It's very. I think without a question, you know, there's, you know, I love what I do, and I do what I do very specifically. Like I'm a chef that really kind of appreciates great American food. Go ahead.
Well, let me ask you the question. The question is this: in this film, Anthony admits to being away 250 days a year. Now you're a father and a husband. When you see his lifestyle, is it possible to be a father and a husband and gone away that amount of time from your family?
Not very well, to be honest with you. Not very well, because I think eventually you drop something, right? So Anthony gave up, you know, two big, very important parts of his life to be Anthony Bourdain. Like he gave up, you know, his first wife. He gave up his second wife. In a lot of ways, in the second part of the movie, it really starts to explore you know, the separation anxiety that turns into, you know, the constant feeling of being distant, to losing interest, to just burning your life down, to reinvent yourself over and over again. And, you know, he stepped away from the restaurant industry, and he stepped away from two marriages.
Yeah.
And he chose to be himself. And in a lot of ways, he probably didn't feel like he had a lot of choice in the matter, because that was just sort of his calling. And, you know, in being famous and being on television, it's my 25th year on television with Food Network. You're often, you know, reminded that, you know, it's fleeting, right? Success doesn't last forever. And you should always kind of make a contingency plan about how you want to gracefully exit, because it'll either happen on your terms or somebody else's terms, but it's going to happen.
How many days a year are you away from your family?
Well, no 2 years are the same. And I have had really long years where, you know, I am not in my own bed for 250 nights. I'm on 90 flights a year. My son just turned 14. I think I've missed 5 of his birthdays.
Well, hold on. Let me ask you about that. Is that okay? Yeah. Is it okay for you to miss 5 birthdays of your own son for your job?
No, it's not. It's not. And when it happens, you know, everybody says, it's okay, Dad. It's okay. You kind of come back the next day and you definitely overcompensate for all this kind of stuff. And you know, and it's family forgives you in a way. But when you're in television and sometimes when you're in the movie business, it's kind of the same thing. They don't really care what else you've got going on in your life. Like, here's the schedule and this is what we're going to go do. And even though you could have carefully planned around that, like some things happen and, you know, some of those birthdays weren't an intentional miss, but you know, the scene ran long and I missed my last flight out that day from where we were, and you know, and the red eye wasn't available, and so I ended up, you know, flying out the next afternoon, which meant I missed his birthday party. So these things happen, and but they really, you know, how long you let it go, I think, will determine how well you manage your mental health out of all this, because you need support. You need somebody in your life to tell you you're fucking up. You need somebody in your life to give you a hug. You need somebody in your life to love you.
Yeah.
And I think Anthony isolated himself in a lot of ways. And then in a very weird way, started attacking people that loved him. Right. Mm-hmm. There was a very really touching moment with several people in the movie that he just kind of just attacked for no reason. Like I've had, you know, in the same month, I would have drinks with Tony Bourdain in the West Village. We'd have a great time. And then, you know, he would attack me in the press for no crazy reason.
What'd he say about you?
Well, you know, there was a moment in time, and here's the deal. I don't want to say I'm a Tony expert on any level whatsoever. I knew Tony how I knew Tony, and there was a lot of people who had a much, much deeper relationship with him than I did. But I knew him, but I think more important than that, I know what he's going through, or I know what he had gone through. And then I kind of, in a way, understand that sometimes you just or want to or have that voice in the back of your head telling you just pull the ripcord and let's just get out of here. Yeah. And this is just not going anywhere. And I'm just not happy anymore. And there's no way to get out.
Chris.
So, and as a writer, go ahead. I'm sorry, man.
No problem. No. Go ahead and finish your thought. As a writer.
But as a writer, you know, Tony wrote his own last chapter the way he wanted to finish his life story.
Well, let's talk.
He finished the book the way he wanted to finish the book and not on anybody else's timetable.
Or growing old gracefully.
Yeah,
exactly.
He wrote the end of the story the way he wanted it read.
Let's talk about that real quick. Chris, I'm going to start with you on this one, mm-hmm. if that's all right.
That's fine.
So in this film, we're teetering on the edge of darkness the whole time.
Of course. But you know the ending.
But. Yeah, in the 1:30 mark of this film, we're introduced to Anthony's last girlfriend, Asia Argento. Mm-hmm. And here's what I got from the end of the movie. And Chris, you tell me if you got something different. Here you have a guy in a very toxic relationship. Everyone around him is trying to help him. He wouldn't listen to anyone until Anthony lost it and hung himself. Did you see that too, or did you see something different? Like, it seemed like everyone was trying to help this guy, and he wouldn't listen to anybody.
I think that there were a lot of people who were trying to help him, and I think that he had these friends over the years who had been around, and they, you know, sometimes people just get caught in despair that way, and this is one of the reasons that I think we always have to have a deep conversation about mental health, and that we have to recognize that people, you know, get to points that they don't think that they would ever get to, even people who are very well connected to other folks, and they feel isolated, and sometimes they want to pull the ripcord, and it's a terrible challenge that I think all humans face in one way or another. And you know, I would have loved to see another, you know, 20 years of Anthony Bourdain, I think that the world will be better for it. And it was a toxic set of circumstances, and I think that was captured very well in the film too.
Yeah. Hey, Tyler, you said something that made me think about Anthony Bourdain. And he said, the way I make up for my strange life is cooking aggressively, practically killing the people around me with food. Eat, eat, eat. Don't you love me? Eat my food. Is that you, Tyler?
Well, you know, there is a manic level of behavior that you could start to see with this constant sort of shift between reality and then compensating for, you know, his alter universe that he lived in for the majority of his life for, you know, 15 years or so. And so when you go back on the reality, and that's something that I personally really identified with, it's hard to talk about and hard to explain where you've been for the last 3 weeks with anybody, even including your wife, just because they don't understand or they won't get it. Like I was in four cities in the last, you know, through 2 weeks, and you know, Oklahoma is one of them, and we stopped off this crazy barbecue place, and we had this whole kind of really good time, and then we had drinks in this bar, and it was fun, and like, and then it just kind of goes over everybody's head. So I think in a lot of ways, once you kind of get back to civilization, that you kind of begin to overcompensate for you not being there, and then it's sort of like, let me just make you happy, and let me just cook for you, don't you love me, and like, and so, and I think in a lot of ways, that's also the behavior of an addict, and that's one thing that we don't really talk about. That was really discussed at the beginning of the movie, but then they really kind of jumped into it towards the end. How he would just sort of assign his addictive behavior to anybody, right, or yeah, any situation currently, right? So he was addicted to heroin.
Heroin early.
And then he was addicted to being a chef, and he was addicted to the show, and he was addicted to Asia Argento, and he was addicted to, you know, he was addicted to his family, and then he wasn't, and then he was addicted. And so I think in a lot of ways, like that and that sort of creeping behavior that you never really, you know, you never really lose. It's like this long comet tail that you just can't particularly shake that would end up becoming manifested in a couple of different parts of his life. And that was my big takeaway. But to me, I think one of the saddest things is how he would just randomly go out and just sort of like blast people.
Yeah.
Because it moved the needle and sold books. Like his whole thing about calling people out and calling the other chefs out for, you know, if they were legitimate or a real chef or they were cooking the real food. I mean, he took swipes at everybody on Food Network. He took swipes at everybody. And you just sort of took it. I mean, it was sort of, you know, like I would talk to other folks on Food Network, and it's just, you know, it's Tony being Tony. And, you know, like, don't get into a Twitter battle with him. It's not worth it. It's dumb. But some of those things would really hurt. I mean, openly attacked Rachel Ray, openly attacked Paula Deen, openly attacked Bobby, openly attacked Bobby because he didn't like Southwestern food, you know, and openly attacked because, but then he went to Mesa Grill and he had the best french fry of his life, and he hated Bobby even more because his french fries were better than his, right? So, and there was one moment in one of the early episodes of No Reservations where he was in New Zealand and he was riding a quad bike up this sandy dune, and he flipped it over and kind of landed a couple of times, and of course they shot all of that and they showed all of it, but right at the end of that scene he said, yeah, and No Reservation was almost just hosted by Tyler Florence. And so he had this sort of like love affair for who we were. And listen, I've seen a lot of people come and I've seen a lot of people go in sort of the food entertainment space. Happens all the time. And I'm just really thinking about how can we make the table bigger? And how can we like share more information and make better broadcasting, that kind of stuff? There was a moment in time when going after other chefs and calling them out for being real or not real. And he and David Chang used to do it all the time. They called bullshit on San Francisco, or they called that was their Tony and Michael Ruhlman had this award ceremony at the South Beach Food and Wine Festival called the Golden Clog. And they would just make up these like ridiculous like things that, you know, other chefs on Food Network, like, basically just laughing at everybody. And so it just became kind of vicious, and that was just sort of his thing. But he knew the louder he did that, the more coverage he got, the more books he sold. And that was just sort of his thing. So I think in a lot of ways he ended up turning off a lot of people that probably he needed, you know, he probably needed a support system. And he apologized to that to me later in life, but it was one of those things that, you know, for that moment in his life, that was just sort of who he was, and he just didn't really, there was no filter. And I think you don't want to filter a guy like that, because I think what he said was just sort of, some of the stuff is just brilliant and some of the stuff is just kind of like mean and cruel. Mm-hmm. But that's just who he was as a person. But to me, one of the, and since we're on sort of this, you know, part two of this, one of the saddest things was that when David Chang had recalled, you know, Tony saying that David would never be a good father.
Mm-hmm.
Right. And who the hell says
who
that?
Says
to somebody?
That? Who says
and if you follow David Chang on social media, he loves his son, and he's just like cooking like Japanese rice and Korean home dishes and all these things. Like, he just loves his son, and that really kind of hurt him deep, man. And like, David Chang never did anything other than just be, you know, Tony's like biggest support system, biggest fan. So there was this dark side to him that he just felt like he could just like take anybody out anytime he wanted to. And then we started kind of going after Harvey Weinstein, and I think in a way like that really kind of like put off Asia Argento. I think it got a little. It got a little weird for her too.
It was almost competitive, being competitive with her in the Me Too side of things.
Yeah.
Well, he just assigned his manic behavior to her. And I just don't think she wanted it. I think she wanted to have, you know, the bad boy, good time life. And I just don't think she wanted, you know, that much airtime or that much attention on herself, or it just became distracting. And then towards the end, it was ultimately, and it's hard to say that, you know, Asia Argento caused that. And it was probably, you know, the straw that broke the camel's back, but you could just tell he was just in a, you know, a depressed, dark place for quite some time.
Yeah.
And it was sad. You know, like the last time I saw him was at a UFC fight in Las Vegas on the floor. I can't remember what fight it was, but I've been a few, but he looked, he was aging, and it looked like he wasn't, you know, taking really good care of himself. But, you know, that being said, I miss him. You know what I mean? I do, because I'd see him a couple times a year, and we always had like a little moment of kind of check-ins, because I've been friends with him forever. I mean, when Bone in the Throat came out, even like before Kitchen Confidential, and there's books before Kitchen Confidential that you definitely have to go check out. I think it's some of his really good, incredibly edgy work. Bone in the Throat is a masterpiece. Okay. That's a great.
That really wasn't well covered. Album. I mean, Kitchen Confidential was presented as not just the breakthrough, but sort of the only thing that got him over the literary hump. But that's news to me. So I'm going to go back and dig up the books.
Yeah, Bone in the Throat's fantastic. Okay. So I was just reading a lot of his work early, and you know, we'd kind of see him in New York before he got like really famous, and it was nice to see him. So at one point in time, he kind of stepped away from the day-to-day work of being a chef. And then he's assumed this role as a storyteller and as a great American writer. And that's really who he was. And so his time in the kitchen kind of gave him, you know, a focus and gave him a level of enthusiasm most people don't share, because he just ate everything everywhere and got a chance to meet everybody.
Tyler.
But go ahead.
Listen, we got to wrap this thing up. We can't go forever. So we're going to go around the horn. Start with Bryn. Should people see this movie? Yes or no?
Oh, 1,000%.
Chris, should people see this movie?
Yeah, no brainers. Like, watch it twice.
Okay. Yeah. So we're all in agreement. Yeah. Everyone go check out this film. We're going to end with one final question for Tyler. Tyler, hopefully, God willing, coronavirus has passed us. I would like you to invite me, Chris, and Bryn over your house for dinner. And we could do a movie review as we eat about our favorite movies that have to do with food. What do you think?
I would love that. And
don't just say that, man.
I live in Marin. You've been to my house, man. Let's come over for dinner sometime. And we'll cook out. We'll grill some steaks. You know, we're getting ready to open up a brand new steakhouse with the Golden State Warriors called Miller & Lux.
Oh, that'll be nice.
So we've got lots of steaks laying around.
That'll be fun.
We'd love to feed you guys. And let's just kind of keep this up, man. There's so many great movies, food or otherwise. And that's part of what I do now, like the second half of my career. Like, I'm a filmmaker. Like, I have an advertising agency. I have a production company. We make television. We make movies. We make short form content for social. It's like little mini movies.
What's the company called?
Which are so much fun to produce. It's called Monarch Collective, our production company.
Monarch.
Nice. And so we're just thrilled. And we do this kind of stuff all the time. And so I love the art of cinema. It's so breathtaking when you get really edgy people that are doing great stuff. And so, yeah, let's do it.
And this is what
dinner and a movie. That's what we'll call it.
Perfect. This nice. Is what Fandor has been about from the beginning. And so we're just so excited to get the Fandor Festival podcast kicked back off with the wonderful Tyler Florence.
Hey, nice. Tyler, one last thing. You want to open up a restaurant with the Sacramento Kings? I think they're,
yeah,
I think
exactly.
they're a better organization.
If you're doing the Warriors, we've got, I mean, we do have Echo and Rig up at Golden One Center in Sacramento, but there's room for a couple of more great restaurants in the downtown Commons. So we'll have to have that conversation too.
Chris, I would love to do that. You know, we live in the Bay Area. You know, Sacramento's up
it's
there
close.
Too.
It's still close. Yep.
Yeah. And there's like so much great culinary talent. Like I remember when we opened up, Wayfair Tavern. Mm-hmm. I feel like I had cleaned the city of Sacramento out of chefs. I thought somebody is going to put a hit out on me for cleaning the city out. But there is some really serious culinary talent up there. I would love to do a restaurant.
All right.
There. That would be amazing.
Come on up. We'll work that out.
Miller
too.
And Lux. Yeah. Miller and Lux. Fantastic story. I'll talk to you about it offline.
We are going to be hosting the California Classic up there first week in August, right before Summer League starts in Vegas. So we'll have a couple of teams up there. So you'll have to come up for that.
In a heartbeat. I would love that.
All right. So listen, everyone. Today's show is brought to you by Fandor. Sign up online for a free one-week trial or download the app on your phone and get 2 weeks free. Playing now on Fandor is the romantic comedy New York, I Love You, starring Natalie Portman, Ethan Hawke, Andy Garcia, and many more. That's Fandor. Tyler, you are second to none.
Thank you, brother. I appreciate this, man. So much fun. Right. Thank you for that link. It was just an honor to watch that movie, and I got a chance to watch it with my daughter, who's 13, and my son is 25, and a lot of the stuff they didn't know, and they looked at me and like, Dad, is that what life is really like? I'm like, absolutely.
Kinda, yeah.
100%, 1,000%, and that's what life is like for me personally as a broadcaster who hits the road a lot. So they just see Dad coming and going with a suitcase, and that's what it's like on the other side of the lens. Yeah.
Nice. Thank you for being the first one, Tyler. It really means a lot to us.
Thanks so much.
Thanks, Tyler.
My pleasure. My pleasure. Anytime, guys. Thank you so much.
All right, brother. Take care.
Thanks for tuning in. Today's show is brought to you by Fandor. Sign up online or in the app for a free one-week trial. Playing now on Fandor is a romantic comedy, New York, I Love You, starring Natalie Portman, Ethan Hawke, Andy Garcia, and many more. That's Fandor. F-A-N-D-O-R.